Sciences. And today he'll talk about developing implantable biosensors that match an individual's metabolism with drug dose.
Thank you, James, for the kind introduction. Let's see if I can share my slides here. All right, here we go. Good morning to everyone. My research program is really building upon this idea of having humans at the center of precision medicine. And we're inspired by the realization that human biology is very beautiful, but also very diverse. So in this very limited sample of all humankind, we can appreciate that there are different ethnic backgrounds, different skin colors, different eye colors, different sexes. And yet our approach to drug therapy for many decades encased all of this beautiful diversity into a single model of drug metabolism, in which we assumed that if you were to take a medication, for example, in the form of a pill, and if we had a means of looking at the concentration of that medication in your bloodstream, we would see the levels rise and fall following a specific drug elimination profile, with the hope that we could take something like the maximum peak concentration of this medication in your blood and use that to develop a functional therapy to treat a disease. Now, all of you are familiar with this concept of, well, I have to take my pill every 8 hours or every 12 hours. And the idea behind those discrete time events is that we can slowly build the concentration of your medication following this black trace on the right-hand side of the slide to hopefully reach a steady state where we hold it within a therapeutic window. However, you can imagine that because we have all of this beautiful diversity in humankind, it is very easily to miss that therapeutic window to then reach either excessively adverse effects or maybe ineffectively low levels of the drug. This is not a big problem for something like aspirin. You will need to take a lot of aspirin to reach toxic doses, but it can be a problem for drugs that are by themselves toxic to the human body. So this is just one example of a very old anti-seizure drug called phenytoin. And I'm just gonna bring your attention to this graph on the right-hand side of the slide. Each one of these red dots represents the peak plasma concentration or the peak concentration in blood of different patients that took a given daily dose. And if I can focus your attention on a dose of 5 mg/kg, you can see that for this large group of people, for this large group of people, there's a deviation in the plasma concentration of the drug that we reach of about an order of magnitude or sometimes more. Right? So really, diversity severely affects drug metabolism. And unfortunately, the only approach that we currently have to addressing this subject-to-subject variability is to use an array of doses that we have to experimentally give to the patients so that we can hopefully find a dose that gives the most benefit with the lowest amount of side effects. We think we can do better. We think we can develop technology that can address this issue at the point of care in a simplified format. Another limitation of our many decades long approach to drug metabolism and drug therapy is that we assume that metabolism is a constant. However, we all are active, so you have to think about the fact that you're taking this medication every 8 or 12 hours, but maybe you ran a marathon, maybe you drank more water or less water, or maybe you ate a very fatty burger, and all of those these elements of your daily routine will be changing the way in which, the speed and the way in which you're metabolizing these drugs. So the vision for my lab is that the development of sensing technologies supporting the continuous real-time measurement of specific molecules directly within the human body, of specific therapeutics within the human body, could potentially transform the way in which we study and understand human health, but also the way in which we study, understand, diagnose, and treat human diseases. We think that such a technology could, for example, enable the measurement of the highly precise measurement of patient-specific drug metabolism so that we could potentially move one step forward towards this idea of precision medicine in which we are determining the dosage given to a patient based on actually measured data as opposed of a populational average or a crude estimate of take one capsule by mouth 3 times a day. We also think that these technologies could enable important medical applications like, for example, feedback control drug delivery in which we are now coupling a little sensor that monitors the levels of the drug in your body which is connected to a drug delivery device, a drug pump, right, via a computer algorithm. So we can finely tune the concentration of the drug in your body to keep it within therapeutic levels, potentially avoiding toxic peaks and ineffectively low concentrations. And then finally, if we allow ourselves to dream about the future, we can imagine incorporating these technologies into our current infrastructure of portable wearable devices so that we could potentially achieve the real-time assessment of health status by, for example, tracking in real time the concentrations of drugs, metabolites, and biomarkers as we are undergoing our daily routines. Now, the approach that we have decided to pursue as a group to kind of bring these concepts to a reality focuses on the development of this technology that I'm showing you on this slide. This technology is called electrochemical aptamer-based sensors. The initial development of this platform was performed by Kevin Plaxco and colleagues at the University of California, Santa Barbara, about 15 years ago. And what my laboratory is doing is we're really trying to push this to work directly within the human body. So we can do real-time measurements of drug metabolism in specific individuals. Now, just to give you a quick description of the technology, we have an electronic conductor that in this cartoon is represented as a gold wire, this yellow thing. We use chemistries to make that conductor compatible with the human body. So we will minimize non-specific binding of proteins and foreign body attacks, trying to eliminate these from the system. We call these chemistries monolayers, but they are just different types of chemistries that we use to protect the conductor. We also functionalize this metallic conductor with a synthetic piece of DNA that we select in vitro because it binds very strongly to a specific molecular target, for example, a drug. And finally, we modify that synthetic piece of DNA with a molecule that we call a reporter, and it is simply a molecule that we can give electrons to or pull electrons from. Now, very importantly, when we immerse this interface in a sample of blood and in the presence of the molecular target that we're trying to sense, the receptor and the target interact with each other. And very importantly, the target will cause a change in the physical conformation of that receptor that in turn changes the electronic properties of this reporter that we have at the end. We can interrogate these sensors serially using different types of voltage perturbations. This is just an example here in the picture. We are sweeping the voltage of the electrode. We are recording the current output from that voltage sweep. And what you see is that in the absence of target, we have something that looks like a peak-shaped response in black. And then if we increase the concentration of target, the expectation is that that signal will increase proportionally to concentration. And in fact, we can do this for a series of different sensors represented here with different colors for an antibiotic, for example, tobramycin. And you can see that the signal of the sensor can be directly correlated to the concentration of the drug following this sigmoidal curve. Now, we can make these sensors small enough to fit inside of the veins of research animals. This is just a photograph of one of the devices that we have fabricated to date. This is a bundle of wires with a sensor at the tip end. The total diameter of this device is about 200 microns, so roughly the size of a human hair. Because these sensors are very malleable and soft, we have to encase them into medical-grade catheters to give structural support to them. We then go ahead and perform surgery in research animals. Specifically, we work with mice and rats. We implant the sensors into their veins. We also have drug infusion lines, and we ensure that the sensors are placed in locations where there's plenty of exchange of blood so that we can quickly equilibrate with any concentrations of drugs available in the system. And the result of that is that for the first time, we can achieve real-time, highly specific, ultra-precise measurements of drug metabolism in vivo in the veins of living breathing rats. This is an example of a baseline signal that then responds to an IV bolus injection of the antibiotic tobramycin, and we do this twice, and you can see the sensors responding to that directly in the vein of an animal. Of course, the idea here is that the platform is generalizable to the detection of other drugs. So remember, by simply switching the synthetic piece of DNA that we use as the receptor for a piece of DNA that binds to different molecules, we can then achieve real-time continuous measurements of these other molecules in vivo. And in this now somewhat outdated panel of profiles, I am showing you the different examples of drugs that we have been trying to measure in vivo. Some of them done by us, some others done by collaborators from China and other parts of the world. We have now successfully monitored concentrations of antibiotics like kanamycin, gentamicin, tobramycin from the family of aminoglycoside antibiotics, also the glycopeptide vancomycin, as well as chemotherapeutics like doxorubicin, irinotecan, and a very important biological molecule, the energy molecule, adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. Now, all of these drugs here on the majority of the panels have a very narrow therapeutic window. That is, controlling their levels in blood is very important to prevent toxicity. And so the obvious connection is, well, can we now develop a computational system that will allow us to connect these sensors to a drug delivery device in the way we envisioned it earlier in this presentation? And so this is the very early demonstration that we have done. We now can connect a drug delivery device that will be infusing drug into the body. We have the sensor placed and connected to our electronics. We use a computer model with a PID controller. And just to keep this very simple, this is the same type of controller that all of you have in your kitchen ovens to adjust the temperature of the oven and keep it constant. We're using the same technology here. Now, our sensors are monitoring concentrations of drug in real time. We turn on the controller and set a reference point to, for example, 30 in this scale. So now the drug will start infusing drug. Our sensor will pick up the infused drug and monitor in real time until it reaches the threshold that we set before turning on the controller. And now we can hold that concentration constant for as long as we want. And when we turn off the controller, we can see again how the drug gets metabolized by the body of, in this case, our rat subjects. So we think that there are many opportunities for this technology in the space of diagnostics and personalized drug therapy, particularly in the context of chemotherapy. And so with this, I'm just gonna finish this by thanking my students. We're a very young group at Hopkins. This is my second year in the institution, and we're starting to receive support, institutional support from Hopkins, but also from private companies, as well as external foundations. And we're really trying to push this forward to the clinic. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right, great. Thank you, Nets. So Allison and Sarah asks, which diseases or conditions do you think might be targeted first for this technology?
Thank you, great question. We're currently focusing on infectious diseases as well as treating cancer. And I think the cancer example is the simplest one. So I'm gonna explain it to you very quickly. If you are undergoing chemotherapy, usually the way you receive that medication is you're sitting in a chair, you have an IV line that is constantly dosing the drug. And what we do is we will draw blood out of the patient after a certain time interval to then quantify in a centralized facility far, far away from the patient what the level of that drug is in your body. Now, the idea here with this technology, remember, it's only 200 microns in diameter, so the size of a human hair. We can slip that line into the vein at the same time that you're receiving your medication, and then monitor in real time how your body is responding to that drug. And so hopefully we can achieve truly personalized, but also highly precise drug therapy under those circumstances.
Great, thank you. Second and last question is, how much does your team collaborate with or is aware of similar efforts going on in the maker and do-it-yourself bio communities? People like Dana Lewis or DIY pancreas system?
This is a great question. We are collaborating with a lot of people. I could mention a few instead of names of institutions, but we are closely collaborating with UC San Diego to develop these into wearable patches so we can do measurements in interstitial fluid. We are actively collaborating with a makerspace here in Baltimore called OpenWorks. And just to illustrate the extent of collaborations that we have, I'm just gonna turn off my virtual background very quickly and show you that I just built my first 3D printer here because I can be in lab, so I'm gonna be printing parts for my students so they can continue to develop the technology from far away. So heavily involved with all the do-it-yourself people in the community.
Great, all right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so our next speaker is